Welcome to Night School. I'm Darian.
And I'm Christina. Night School is a program of the California Academy of Sciences Nightlife, a weekly in-person program for adults that mixes science, culture, and art every Thursday night. And we're the online version.
If you're a regular, you probably already know this. And if you're new, welcome. But Night School is a program all about learning. And so often we conflate learning with knowing. But tonight, we're exploring a lot more than just what we know about the natural world. We're taking a look at how we use art, like writing, performance, and poetry, to examine not just what we know about the natural world, but how we feel about the natural world, how we talk about the natural world, and how we connect to the natural world, all in an effort to develop a more robust understanding of the changing world and our place in it.
So we have an excellent lineup of guests tonight. And much like you, the viewers who I see are tuning in from all across the country, they're also joining us from different weather events. So first up, we have Rachel Garber Cole, who joins us from Brooklyn, where she's an artist whose work in performance, video, and sculpture investigates the emotional, psychological, and sensorial experiences living in the climate crisis. She's going to present excerpts from her work, Questions for a Dinosaur, which Darian has seen in person, an eco-anxiety audit in which she asks herself, when am I fearful for the future? What am I fearful for exactly? And then Ruth Nolan joins us from the desert. She's a former wildland firefighter now an author and professor of English and creative writing and curator of the ongoing humanities-based multimedia project, Fire on the Mojave, Stories from the Deserts and Mountains of Inland Southern California. She'll be discussing the world of wildfire and firefighting and reading from her newest book, After the Dome Fire. And then finally, Craig Santos Perez joins us from Hawaii, where he's a poet, scholar, editor, publisher, essayist, critic, artist, environmentalist, and political activist. And he'll be reading selections of eco-poetry from his book, Habitat Threshold, focusing on climate change, environmental justice, extinction, and ecological relations.
We have such a multi-hyphenate cast of guests tonight.
I know.
As always, tonight's program is live, so say hi, let us know where you're watching from. Whether you're a first-time watcher or you're a Night School regular, we know you, we see you, we love you. We will have Q&As after each speaker, so feel free during the presentations to leave your questions in the comments and we'll get to them. Up first, we will be hearing from Rachel Garber Cole.
Hi, Christina and Darian, thank you so much for having me. I'm really happy to be here. Great. Yes, this is my slideshow. I am an artist based in Brooklyn. I make multidisciplinary project-based work. My background is in theater, so at the heart of most of my work is performance and writing. And today I'm going to talk to you about the current work that I've been working on for about the past 10 years, where I've been exploring the emotional, psychological, the emotional and psychological experience of living in this moment of climate crisis, and specifically how I use an interrogative framework in order to explore this topic. I ask, why isn't this working? There we go. So I ask, what does it feel like to live on a rapidly warming planet? And I came to this project of exploring the micro personal lived experience of this macro phenomenon, really because I've had a lifelong experience and struggle with eco-anxiety. When I learned about global warming in the mid-90s, it was talked about as something far away and something very abstract. But for some reason, I felt like it was a real personal threat to my future even then. And I grew up in an educated, white, upper middle class family in New England. So I was promised that every generation would do better than the generation before them. And I saw global warming as this existential threat to that promise. So I've always had this sense of dread about the future. And for many years, I had a problem with language. I couldn't really talk about this feeling of dread because I couldn't identify the feeling as dread. It felt like ambient anxiety. I didn't have the word eco-anxiety. And compounding the problem was this fact that nobody at the time seemed to want to talk about it with me. No one seemed willing or interested in talking about global warming as a thing that was happening to us at this moment. And I really needed to have a conversation with other people to help me contextualize the change that I felt like I was experiencing in the world. And a conversation that went beyond nihilism or anodyne statements of hope. But I didn't know how to have that conversation because I didn't even have the language to talk about my own experiences. So language allows us to see the world that lies in front of us. And without a vocabulary for the experience of change, I found it really hard for me to shift my understanding of this world in transition from a previous understanding of a world of continuity and forward progress to a world that's more discontinuous and uncertain. So like all my neuroses and anxieties, I look for answers in my art practice. So I went about trying to find my own language for this moment by researching geological deep time, other moments in Earth's history that experienced major climactic change. And during this research of the five major extinction events, I began a conversation with a dinosaur where I started asking her questions about extinction because she's the expert. And this conversation turned into an anxiety audit where I tried to specifically articulate what I felt anxious about when I thought about the climate crisis. And asking these questions revealed to me my own relationship with time and comfort and modernity and stability and family and fragility and my own position in global power. And then these questions sort of became answers to a new question that rose out of these questions, which is, when I am fearful for the future, what am I fearful for exactly? So the video, Questions for a Dinosaur, is what came out of that inquiry. And I'll play a 2-minute clip right now of this 9-minute video. It's the first 2 minutes of the video.
Hi. What is my role during a mass extinction? What is expected of me? What does it feel like to go extinct? Does it hurt? What does it look like for me and my children? Can I save myself and my loved ones? What does it mean to survive when we all die anyway? What is my imagination for what extinction looks like versus what does it actually look like? Question for myself. Because of our opposable thumbs, do humans have a chance of survival? Are we currently living through a mass extinction, in your professional opinion? What will it look like when we come out of it, of an extinction event? How long will that take? And also, who will be there to witness it? What should I be doing? Should I be having children to ensure the survival of our species? Or should I not be having children so that they do not have to live through this horror? What will my own eyes see? Because I will grow old, hopefully, and die most definitely. And will I live to see a world that I do not recognize? Again, what will it look like and will it be horrible? What else am I not asking you that I should be asking you? Will we discover new and exciting creatures born out of this brave new world? Will our children? How far down the generational pipeline must I travel before I no longer care about the fate of my lineage? My loved ones, loved ones, loved ones, loved ones. Does it hurt, extinction?
And so this work has been... Here we go. I'm lost. Here we are. So I've iterated this project as a live performance. I've done a 52-print portfolio where I reimagined the dinosaur. I became the dinosaur in these photos. And then I'm working on a book of these images and questions. So after I had this conversation with myself through this project, I felt like I finally was able to bring this conversation to other people. So The Warmest Years on Record is an ongoing oral history project that collects audio recorded interviews that discuss participants' emotional, psychological, sensorial, and environmental experiences of living in the climate crisis. So I'll share some of the questions that I asked during my conversations with people. When did you first learn about climate change? Has your understanding of it changed from then to now? Has there been a moment when climate change showed up in your own backyard? And what changed for you after that? In what ways do concerns about climate crisis impact the way you plan for your future? How do you make sense of this moment of unprecedented change? How do you contextualize it? Are there spiritual, ethical, or value-based belief systems that help you understand it? What do you feel like you've already lost? What do you fear losing? Are there ways that you grieve? What do you feel hopeful for? So I've been conducting rounds of interviews since 2018, and then most recently I've worked with the New York City Parks Department, and I interviewed over 60 community gardeners at community gardens across Brooklyn. And then this year I took those interviews with gardeners and I developed a public art project. I created signs installed outside of all 13 participating gardens, and each sign had a unique question that was inspired by my conversations with people, and a QR code which links to an audio collage where I used the material of the interviews, used clips from those interviews as a way to answer or explore each of those questions. So 13 questions, 13 audio collages for all of the 13 signs. And I'm going to share with you the first 2 minutes of a 7-minute audio collage for the question, what do you fear for the future in a rapidly warming world? And actually, Aria, will you, when this is over, bring it back out of full screen, because I'm not going to be able to hear when this audio is done. Thanks.
Fear, I mean, that's a curious thought, because I feel like I'm always afraid.
What I fear and what I see are kind of the same thing.
The destruction.
Of what, exactly?
Of the planet.
Like an increase of just a lot of natural sort of disasters, bigger storms, earthquakes.
I fear for the death of the honeybees.
Bumblebees basically pollinate most of all our food. In my garden, every year I get less and less. I have more carpenter bees than bumblebees. It's not a good thing.
Something bad is happening. It's not right. Something is not right. You know, what I felt is, oh my God, we're not gonna make it.
What does that mean?
I mean, everything is going bad. Everything has changed. And you see it now, it's changing everything.
I am not afraid. One, I am not afraid. People are trying to mimic weather, trying to do other things with weather. When I think about climate, I think about God. He's the one that controls it.
I think my biggest fear for the future is that we are not going to have enough resources to support the people just within the United States.
And the emotional toll that does on the individual. To keep seeing these natural disasters, or to keep seeing these forests burning, and the animals also that suffer. That's what I'm fearful. And for children who have to see that too.
It's not gonna be the whole planet. I don't think God is that wicked. Like, I'm not stressing about it. The reason why I may stress a little about it, because I have young ones. I want them to survive. Even if I'm not here, I want them to survive all that stuff. That's why I try to teach them, you know, pay attention.
Like, I have sons who are thinking now about marriage and children, and I have a lot of fears around what the world's going to look like, even in, you know, 20 years.
So in addition to letting people listen in on some of the conversations that I've been having with folks over the past year, this sidewalk art is also meant to provide opportunities for public conversations by offering questions as vocabulary, as language that may help articulate an idea, a thought, a fear, an expectation that's felt but might not be spoken. And then it also draws attention to the importance of green spaces in our city, because if we're going to survive the climate crisis, we need to have much more green space in our urban environments. So through all of this work, it's become clear to me that through my practice asking and generating questions to myself and to others has become a really useful way for me to understand and live my life in this moment of climate transition. You know, I feel like I have one foot on the ground of a stable system of modernity, and then another foot is like dangling off of a cliff. And as climate crisis upends my previous understanding of past, present, and future, this practice helps to ground me in a new narrative. So through my oral history interviews, a new question has emerged that's been sticky. Two parts. How do I show up for this moment? But really what I'm asking is, you know, what is it to be involved in meaningful change? And what does meaningful change mean when it comes to action on an individual basis? So I had a baby 5 months ago, actually 6 months ago at this point. And I forgot to do a sign. This work is a work in progress called The Possibility of a Door. So all of a sudden my life has become much less abstract, much more immediate. I'm starting to ask new questions for this profoundly new experience, but I don't know what those questions are. And I'm going to end this kind of open-ended with no clear conclusion, because that's like where I feel I'm at and where we're at right now. So, thank you so much for having me and listening to me talk about my work.
Thank you so much, Rachel. So appreciate you sharing kind of the anxieties that you've had in such an honest way. I know that's really resounded with me through your work. So thank you for that. Thank you for sharing here. We have some great questions from the audience, but I would like to encourage everyone to continue to ask them. We will get to them right now. So Celia asks that in your questions for a dinosaur work, what was the significance of the dinosaur not responding or just being a physical presence there?
Well, the truth is I had no answers. So I don't know how the dinosaur would have responded. And it also kind of came out of a conversation I was having with a friend. I was working on this and I was like trying to talk as the dinosaur, and it was real gobbledygook. And I was talking to him and I was like, well, he was like, well, what are the answers? Like, what would you say? And I was like, well, there's no answers. He's like, maybe the dinosaur doesn't need to say anything. So my friend gave me permission to not have answers. And so the dinosaur just kind of becomes a presence that you can kind of reflect off of.
Mm-hmm. So as someone who is all too familiar with climate anxiety, does your work, either in the process of creating it or the product, help to quell that anxiety for you, or have you seen that in others?
I don't know if it's because of my work or just because I've been working through it over time. So maybe that's kind of two of the same things. I think that I'm in a very different position now than I was years ago when I was first trying to make this work and make sense of the work. And I don't have a lot of climate anxiety, although in many ways I do, especially because I have a 6-month-old son, which changes the calculus of my own thinking about a future. But I think that working through my anxieties through my art practice has helped me think through what those anxieties are and what are alternative ways of imagining the future. So I think I was able to kind of understand how my anxieties were more self-centered, and then thinking about, you know, there's a lot of other ways of imagining the future that are more, that engage in more imagination.
Yeah, absolutely. It seems like a very healthy and thorough way to like examine your own feelings. Through projects like The Warmest Years on Record, how or has your conversations with others changed your feelings at all? Have there been any ideas that you've received from others and thought like, wow, this is really valuable for me. This is helpful.
Yeah. And pretty significantly, when I started in 2018, I started just kind of talking to people in my network and sort of, you know, my like second tier network, which is people around my age in New York City. And the conversations were like really nihilistic, pretty hopeless, and a lot of paralysis. And, you know, I don't like really travel in a lot of activist circles. So a lot of people didn't have the habit of activism, but there was a lot of habits of paralysis. And as I kept hearing people, and I should say that I started this work with the perspective of, you know, we're screwed. There's nothing we can do to stop catastrophic climate crisis. And so we need to figure out how we can live psychologically in chaos. And as I started listening to people talk about paralysis, I started getting really angry at the paralysis. Like, what? Like, of course there's things we can do than sitting around on our couch, like, you know, talking about like our doomsday plans. Like, this is crazy. And then I went up and I did the interviews up at the History Center in Tompkins County up in Ithaca. And I talked to a lot of anti-fracking activists and farmers and climate scientists. And they had a very different perspective of the future and their role in the present and the future. And that was sort of what shifted my imagination for what my work can do, what I can do in the present, and you know, other ways that I keep using the word imagine, but it's the best word I can think of. Imagine a future and sort of act in ways that work to catalyze that future. Mm. So very significantly, actually, yeah.
That's actually very hopeful. And I do so appreciate how like multi-pronged and multidisciplinary your influences are. And that's, okay, one final question from Deep. Have you considered how to make art in a way that doesn't contribute to consumption?
I have thought about this. I mean, my art isn't hugely consumptive because it's very small scale. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, pretty much outside of capitalism because I don't make any money off of it. And I know some artists who are working really hard to do that. But for me, it feels like focusing on the specific consumption of my own art practice sort of misses the mark on like what the art can maybe catalyze for other people on a larger scale. So, you know, I mean, I try not to have like crazy consumption in my art, but it feels like not quite the question I'm interested in with my work. So it's not my primary focus.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you so much for sharing. Really appreciate it. Up next, we will hear from Ruth Nolan.
I'm sorry, I was muted. I'm coming at you from the California desert, which is a bit warmer than it, for many of you logging in from colder parts of the country. So I'm sending you sunshine and Joshua trees. Well, I'm going to show you a short video. That's a collaborative effort between my book publisher, Bamboo Dart Press, a really cool indie press here in Southern California, and for my book, After the Dome Fire, which I will be reading from as part of my presentation. So we're going to watch that now.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed the video. The lines of poetry in the book, or I'm sorry, in the video, are from one of the poems called Mopping Up in my fire book, After the Dome Fire. And mopping up is the work. You see me there with a shovel back on one of the fire crews I worked on. And that's a very tedious, laborsome job that firefighters do long after the fire is out. A lot of people don't see that part of the work, but it's very important also to help the fires from breaking out again. Boots on the ground. Fighting wildfire, it's really hard work. I fell into it by a fluke. Growing up in a remote part of the Mojave Desert, which is remote to begin with, there weren't a lot of jobs for young adults. I worked for 7 fire seasons in the 1980s for the U.S. Forest Service and Bureau of Land Management's California Desert District throughout California and the Western U.S. on hand, line, engine, and helicopter hotshot crews. Along the way, I learned important life skills, such as the importance of physical and mental fitness and teamwork, the intricacies of fire weather, fire behavior, and fire impacts, how to study the land, terrain, geography, how to work with specific tools, and the 10 basic rules of firefighting, which I realized today not only applied to safety, survival, procedure, and accomplishment of goals on the fire line, but serve as basic life skills for anyone. As I evolved from my work as a young adult during my college years, as a seasonal wildland firefighter, into my current profession as an educator and author. A bit regretfully, as in looking back, I realized that it would have been amazing to continue in a full-time career as a wildland firefighter. And whenever I see a wildfire breakout, which is pretty common here in California, where I live, I get excited. I want to still go out and do the work and work with my teammates. And, you know, I probably shouldn't do that. I might not be able to make it out there anymore, but being trained and knowing the intricacies of the work, it's very hard sometimes to restrain myself. I came to realize there are many links between boots on the ground and learning about and from the omnipresence of wildfire here in our Golden State and throughout the West. We all have an obligation to build relationships between ourselves and where we live. And this also feeds into Rachel's presentation. How do we become part of the solution and work to abate and hopefully stem climate change and eco-ecology crises and the collapse of our natural world? I think there's a lot we can do when it comes to wildfire. Becoming stewards of the places we love, we are able to make an impact, not only on preventing fires, but on mitigating the damages of fires. I also have seen over the years that I have a unique opportunity to serve as a liaison between firefighters, the work of firefighting, and the public as someone who has both done the work with boots on the ground and now writes poetry and teaches about it. Here for all of us to consider for intentional living with wildfire are the 10 standard firefighting orders. 1, keep informed on fire weather at all times. 2, know what the fire is doing at all times. 3, base all actions on current and expected behavior of fire. Study fire weather conditions and forecast. This would include red flag warnings in our forest and natural places, and really, really respect those warnings. If you're being asked not to build a fire in Joshua Tree National Park, you need to heed the warning. 6, be alert. Post lookouts when there is possible danger. 7, maintain prompt communication with your forces, your boss, and adjoining forces. 8, give clear instructions and be sure they're understood. 9, maintain control of your forces at all time. 10, fight fire aggressively, having provided for safety first. Think clearly and act decisively. And a little bit about the poetry of firefighting. In the beginning, they laid a woman, Nimaiwat, palm on her back, took a wooden spindle and drilled her. First blood, then fire came forth. This woman then became a palm tree. This is from Tamalpak, Kaweah Indian knowledge and usage of plants. The intentional living with wildfire means that we all have an obligation to build these eco-poetic relationships by understanding, interacting with, and caring for the land that we live on in the West. Building relationships between us, where we live, and the omnipresence of wildfire as a natural force that's both destructive and regenerative in nearly all of California's ecologic zones. We learn to see that nature and wildfire is truly a learning landscape. In writing and publishing poetry and essays for my ongoing humanities project, Fire on the Mojave, Stories from the Deserts and Mountains of Inland SoCal, I've learned quite a bit about the centuries-long traditional role of fire for many of our indigenous California people, which is really a critical element in the current state and near future of wildfire management here in the West, to work to build sustainable relationships with wildfires and the presence of fires and the prevention of these big mega fires that we're seeing happen. The practice by many California tribes for centuries using good fire, traditional practices always used by many tribes and others. One example comes from the Honorable Ron Good, tribal chairman of the Norfolk Mono tribe, which has been practicing what is known as cultural burning for nearly 30 years. He says, cultural burns are a form of land management passed down by indigenous tribes over thousands of years. It is called cultural burning not only because of its spiritual and cultural importance to indigenous communities, but because the burns are designed to cultivate the biodiverse, sustainable growth that makes landscapes more resilient. The action of the hands-on physicality of working as a wildland firefighter also includes a mental and intellectual knowledge and understanding are very similar to the act of writing and reading and performing poetry. Wherein our senses and connection to our physical beings are evoked and we feel that we're becoming alive. It's great fun to interpret and work with wildfire now. And all these years after I've hung up my boots, and I still have my old white custom made 8-inch high firefighting boots. Through my writing with words, I can impart experience, knowledge, and regeneration using the gift and power of language and share this with others in hopefully meaningful, instructive, and inspirational ways. And now I'm going to share a few poems with you from my new poetry chapbook, which was just released this fall. So I wanted to read four poems, and I realized that the film trailer I showed you from my book actually recounted one of the poems mopping up, so I won't read that one. But that poem is a presentation on the work, some of the work of fighting fire. So the following poem, Fire Behavior, addresses some of the causes of wildfire. Fire behavior. Hobo arsonists, dry lightning, exhaust pipes, weed whackers, illegal campfires, utility lines, gender reveal parties, epic drought, high winds, fatal heat, brittle plants, vertical terrain, fractious combustion, champagne bottle explosions, people trying to escape but nowhere to go, bluebirds, warblers, sparrows plummet aflame, the air hot and thick as tar, blind evacuation, fatal migration. This is the largest Joshua tree forest in the world, says a sign in the middle of the 25,000 acre dome fire burn zone in the East Mojave National Preserve. This fire burned in 2020, and you saw some of the images of what it looks like now out there in the East Mojave, an area that I go to a lot. All of the burned up charred cinders. It's pretty heartbreaking. After this before song, after this, a domed landscape of Joshua trees torn up by a firestorm. After this, the high ridge for agave collecting has burned to a crisp. After this, it has been years since you saw a desert tortoise crawl. After this, the ruby-throated hummingbirds are desperate with thirst. After this, a young chuckwalla doesn't back down from its fierce rock. After this, the long-eared owls claiming their only tree, portending death. After this, the rattlesnake shaman circles so hard to see it makes you cry. After this, the heat is killing more people this year than ever before. After this, the tender landscape, fragile, fragmented, and broken light. After this, people volunteer to replant Joshua trees, to rebuild what has been burned and lost. After this, people songs, one trail leading to and from another broken start. after this, the fluid memory song in the Cottonwood Oasis, where someone died. After this, the first and only evening star, remembered long before its white heart explodes. So I hope you enjoyed hearing those poems and watching the video.
Thank you so much, Ruth, for sharing all that. I think, just hearing from somebody who's been just on the forefront of that for so long is a wonderful and eye-opening perspective to hear. So, I'm curious. I really was interested in the 10 rules of firefighting. Are there any that have implications outside of fires, any that you've thought about in other parts of your life?
Yeah, I really like the one about know your escape route, because I did get caught on a fire once. I'm one of the lucky people. I know a lot of firefighters who've had to get into their fire shelters when fires blow up. And I came really close a few times and did not have to get in, but we were ready to deploy those shelters. Yeah. And I just think that's a very good instruction for life. In a metaphoric sense for everyday living, like if you're getting yourself into a situation, you might know where the door is. But also for those of us living out here in the West, it's really important to know, you know, the terrain and the lay of the land where you're living, that mm-hmm. instead of a fire just suddenly happening and you're scared and caught off guard, like how are you going to leave the area quickly if you have to? Do you have a plan? And I think that anywhere I go in the West, I'm always thinking that way because I had worked as a firefighter. If I'm camping somewhere, I'm thinking, what if a fire breaks out? And I was actually caught on a hike once where I did have to hike out and kind of outrun a wildfire. And I was kind of thinking of, you know, when I first saw the big smoke break out, I was like, if that gets any worse, I'm going to head out the other direction, you know? And so I kind of formed a plan the minute I saw the flames and the smoke.
Yeah.
Awareness and preparation. Stem from that.
Yeah. Those rules. Wonderful. Yeah, definitely. And also I'm just wondering about like the animal communities where you live, and you know, you mentioned some of them in your poems, and just what have you been, it's a big question, but like kind of what have you noticed about the wildlife communities where you live, and like what are you maybe more attuned to since you were working with wildfires? And seeing the damage.
Well, having lived in the Mojave and California deserts for most of my life, the amount of damage to the environment is staggering. Having sort of a long view from childhood, it's really hard to wrap my head around sometimes. It's really depressing. The drastic reduction in all animals. Like I said in one of my poems, I never really see desert tortoises anymore in the wild. Unless you go to like Joshua Tree National Park, because it's one little bubble, one little small island where they're actually not being completely attacked and their habitat destroyed. But, you know, every big major wildfire takes out more just up the road from where I live in the Santa Rosa San Jacinto Mountains National Park, or it's a monument, not a park. There was a 400 acre fire that burned through 600 year old pinyon tree growth, and that fire burns so hot and intensely, there's a very good chance those trees are never going to come back, and that those would shelter a lot of the, you know, plants and animals of our region. So we're just looking at wipeouts, and I do see quite a few less of everything: rattlesnakes, desert tortoise, is it fire destroying habitat or development, cilia, both. And also large-scale renewable energy projects are devouring and desecrating large chunks of public land. I work with groups, and this is a hard sell in the public because we want to develop renewable energy, but we don't want to see more destruction of our natural environment. So how do we balance that? Where do we site it? How do we get that to be a more sustainable business and not at the expense of the desert? Women are just smarter than us. I'm sorry, I'm reading the comments. I worked on a lot of cruise, and I was the only woman on many crews. And I have to say, there was one crew, every single guy on that crew got hurt. And I was the only one that didn't get injured. And I think it's probably because I was more careful. I don't know. I was just lucky. I like your comment, Germ. Thanks.
Yeah. And then finally, has writing poetry given you any new perspectives on your connection to nature? Or is it just a way to communicate your existing perspective?
Well, it's given me a lot of new perspectives, because when I was doing the firefighting work, I never really thought about, I wrote a little bit, but I didn't think about like being an educator, being a public spokesperson, trying to teach people about fires. When I had my daughter, she's in her early 30s now, but I realized there was an important, you know, role I had to play in teaching her. And I didn't read that one poem I was going to read, but teaching my daughter to put out fire. We actually saw someone had left a campfire that wasn't put out, and it was kind of stirring to life in the wind. So I taught her how to put it out and make sure it was cold. And she's like, was only 6 years old, but she's like, Mom, that was so important. Like, I really remember that, you know? And like, when I go camping, I think about it and I practice making sure the fire's out. So poetry has been a way to articulate the deep lessons of landscape, and also render it into a learning landscape, as I mentioned. And that's, these are concepts that I have learned from my studies of Indigenous people and their relationships with fire. So I owe a lot to my understanding that, you know, it's just fighting fire and being heroic, but it's also nurturing, caretaking, stewardship kind of work. But everybody's able to participate in that. You don't have to be an actual firefighter. So I think the poetry has helped me realize that and evoke it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's wonderful. Thank you so much for being with us tonight, Ruth.
I was a little bit stumbling at the beginning. I'm a little tired. It's been a long teaching semester. So.
Well, thank you so much. It was wonderful.
Thank you.
And next up, we have Craig Santos Perez.
Half a day, aloha. Thank you so much to Darian and Christina for having us. Thank you to the California Academy of Sciences. Thank you to Ruth and Rachel for those very inspiring presentations. And thank you so much for everyone joining us live and virtually. I'm going to read some poems from my most recent book, Habitat Threshold. It's a collection of eco-poetry published by a small press called Omnidon, which is in Oakland, California. So it's nice to connect with all you folks in California. This first poem is called Age of Plastic. The doctor presses the plastic probe against my pregnant wife's belly. Plastic leaches estrogenic and toxic chemicals. Ultrasound waves pulse between plastic tissue, fluid, and bone until the embryo echoes. Plastic makes this possible. My wife labors at home in an inflatable plastic tub. Plastic disrupts hormonal and endocrine systems. After delivery, she stores her placenta in a plastic freezer bag. Plastic is the perfect creation because it never dies. Our daughter sucks on a plastic pacifier. Whales, plankton, shrimp, and birds confuse plastic for food. The plastic pump whirls. Breast milk drips into a plastic bottle. Plastic keeps food, water, and medicine fresh. Yet how empty plastic must feel to be birthed, used, then disposed by us degrading creators. In the oceans, 1 ton of plastic exists for every 3 tons of fish. How free plastic must feel when it finally arrives to the paradise of the Pacific gyre. Will plastic make life impossible? Our daughter falls asleep in a plastic crib, and I dream that she's composed of plastic so that she, too, will survive our wasteful hands. So I'm zooming in from the island of Oahu in the Hawaiian archipelago. And so all these poems take place here in Hawaii. This next poem very much speaks to Ruth's work. It's called Rings of Fire. We host our daughter's first birthday party during the hottest April in history. Outside, my dad grills meat over charcoal. Inside, my mom steams rice and roasts vegetables. They've traveled from California, where drought carves trees into tinder. Paradise is burning. When our daughter's first fever spiked, the doctor said it's a sign she's fighting infection. Bloodshed surges with global temperatures which know no borders. If her fever doesn't break, the doctor continued, take her to the emergency room. Airstrikes detonate hospitals in Yemen, Iraq, Afghanistan, South Sudan. When she crowned, my wife said, it felt like rings of fire. Volcanoes erupt along Pacific fault lines. Sweltering heat waves scorch Australia. Forests in Indonesia are razed for palm oil plantations. Their ashes flock like ghost birds to our distant rib cages. Still, I crave an unfiltered cigarette, even though I quit years ago and my breath no longer smells like my grandpa's overflowing ashtray. His parched cough still punctures the black lungs of cancer and denial. If she struggles to breathe, the doctor advised, give her an asthma inhaler. But tonight we sing happy birthday and blow out the candles together. Smoke trembles as if we all exhaled the same flammable wish. This next poem takes us kind of to the ocean, to one of my daughter's favorite places, the aquarium here in Waikiki. It's called A Sonnet at the Edge of the Reef. We dip our hands into the outdoor reef exhibit and touch sea cucumber and red urchin as butterfly fish swim by. A docent explains, once a year after the full moon, when tides swell to a certain height and salt water reaches the perfect temperature, only then will the ocean cue coral polyps to spawn in synchrony a galaxy of gametes, which dances to the surface, fertilizes, opens, forms larvae, roots to seafloor, and grows generation upon generation. At home, we read a children's book, The Great Barrier Reef, to our daughter snuggling between us in bed. We don't mention corals bleaching, reared in labs, or frozen. And isn't our silence, too, a kind of shelter? So, you know, speaking of animals, I have several poems in this book about human-animal relations, you know, during a time of climate change. And so this next poem takes place at another one of my daughter's favorite places, the Honolulu Zoo. And we happen to be there for World Elephants Day. This poem is called Blood Ivory. When we reach the elephant enclosure, I lift our daughter up so she can see them playing in shallow ponds. Look, I say, they love the water just like you. Today, 96 elephants are being massacred across Africa's scarred savanna. Armed poachers surround the herds who stomp, trumpet, and encircle their calves. Bullets, those small human tusks, bite through thick, wrinkled skin. Do the men still feel awe or majesty, or do they only feel their own awful poverty as they sever the incisors once used to split bark and forage? Warlords will sell this white gold to be carved into jewelry, relics, and art, then smuggled across the planet, our man-made elephant graveyard. This year, 35,000 will be slain. Our daughter waves goodbye to them as we walk towards the exit. Do we build zoos to save what we've sacrificed? to display what we dominate, or to cage our own wild urge to kill every breathing being. Our daughter plays with a stuffed elephant doll in the gift shop. Look, I say, it has ears, eyes, and a mouth, just like you. She touches its tusks, smiles, then touches her own teeth. So besides elephants, my daughter really likes birds. And so this next poem is about a native Hawaiian bird called the Kauai o'o, which is a kind of honey creeper. And it was last heard here in 1987. It's titled The Last Safe Habitat. I don't want our daughter to know that Hawaii is the bird extinction capital of the world. I don't want her to walk around the island feeling haunted by tree roots buried under concrete. I don't want her to fear the invasive predators who slither, pounce, bite, swallow, disease, and multiply. I don't want her to see paintings and photographs of birds she'll never witness in the wild. I don't want her to imagine their bones in dark museum drawers. I don't want her to hear their voice recordings on the internet. I don't want her to memorize and recite in school the names of 77 lost species and subspecies. I don't want her to draw a timeline with the years each was first collected and last sighted. I don't want her to learn about the Kauai o'o, who was observed atop a flowering ohia tree, calling for a mate day after day, season after season, because he didn't know he was the last of his kind. Until one day he disappeared forever into a nest of avian silence. I don't want our daughter to calculate how many miles of fencing is needed to protect the endangered birds that remain. I don't want her to realize the most serious causes of extinction can't be fenced out. I want to convince her that extinction is not the end. I want to convince her that extinction is just a migration to the last safe habitat on Earth. I want to convince her that our winged relatives have arrived safely to their destination, a wondrous island with a climate we can never change, and a rainforest fertile with seeds and song. So for my final poem, it was written a few years ago for the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe and water protectors around the world. It's called Chanting the Waters. Water is life, because our bodies are 60% water. Because my wife labored for 24 hours through contracting waves, because water breaks forth from shifting tectonic plates. Water is life, because amniotic fluid is 90% water, because she breathed and breathed and breathed, because our lungs are 80% water, because our daughter crowned like a new island. Water is life, because we tell creation stories about water, because our language flows from water, because our words are islands writ on water, because it takes more than 3 gallons of water to make a single sheet of paper. Water is life, because water is the next oil, because 180,000 miles of US oil pipelines leak every day, because we wage war over gods and water and oil. Water is life, because our planet is 70% water, because only 3% of global water is fresh water, because it takes 2 gallons of water to refine 1 gallon of gasoline, because it takes 20 gallons of water to make a pound of plastic, because it takes 600 gallons of water to make 1 hamburger, because the average American water footprint is 2,000 gallons a day. Water is life, because 1 billion people lack access to drinking water, because women and children walk 4 miles every day to gather clean water and deliver it home. Water is life, because corporations privatize, dam, and bottle our waters, because plantations divert our waters, because animal slaughterhouses consume our waters, because pesticides, chemicals, lead, and waste poison our waters. Water is life, because they bring their bulldozers and drills and drones, because we bring our feathers and lei and sage and shells and canoes and hashtags and totems, because they call us savage and primitive and riots, because we bring our treaties and the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, because they bring their banks and politicians and dogs and paychecks and pepper spray and bullets, because we bring our songs and schools and prayers and chants and ceremonies, because we say stop, keep the oil in the ground, because they say shut up and vanish, but we are not moving, because we bring all our relations and all our generations and all our live streams. Water is life, because our drumming sounds like rain after drought echoing against taut skin, because our skin is 60% water. Water is life, because every year millions of children die from waterborne diseases, because every day thousands of children die from waterborne diseases, because by the end of this poem, five children will die from waterborne diseases. Water is life, because our daughter loves playing in the ocean, because someday she'll ask, where does the ocean end? Because we'll point to the dilating horizon. Water is life, because our eyes are 95% water, because we'll tell her ocean has no end, because sky and clouds lift ocean, because mountains embrace ocean into blessings of rain, because ocean, sky, rain fills aquifers and lakes, because ocean, sky, rain, lake flows into the Missouri River, because ocean, sky, rain, lake, river returns to the Pacific and connects us to our cousins at Standing Rock, because our blood is 90% water. Water is life, because our hearts are 75% water, because I'll teach my daughter our people's word for water, hanum, hanum, hanum. So the sound of water will always carry her home. Water is life. Water is life. Water is. Thank you, everyone, for listening.
And thank you so much for sharing. That was so profound, like very powerful, and beautiful and painful, and it all felt very important. So thank you. We have some great questions. To begin, how and when did you begin to use poetry as a medium to kind of express these ideas that you have?
Yeah, I think for me, poetry has always been a way where I can kind of express my thoughts and emotions and to really process, you know, what I've been experiencing. And, you know, when my first daughter was born in 2014, it was also the same year as the UN Climate Summit. And so the anxieties that you know, Rachel spoke about, both in terms of the environmental anxieties, but also the anxieties of being a parent, kind of collided. And that's when I started writing this book.
Yeah, it's happened somewhat unintentionally that all of our guests have relationships to the environment and the future of their environment through family and through like that kind of generational connection. Mm-hmm. And I wonder how, both as a parent, but also as an educator and someone who teaches, how do you kind of like nurture this love for the environment or for whatever a subject, and then paired with this sometimes painful understanding of what the reality can be?
Yeah, for me, I try to spend as much time in nature as possible. You can see I have pictures in the background of a lot of hikes I've been on the island. And you know, I often go running or swimming at the beach nearly every day. And being within the beauty and wondrousness of the natural world really inspires me to and gives me the strength, honestly, to kind of face the challenges we have in front of us and to become involved in the environmental movements here in Hawaii, but also, of course, to try to show solidarity with movements around the world, as that last poem showed.
Definitely. Just to be outside, it does help. In like your ideal world, how do you want your art to impact other people? Or do you prescribe that at all?
Well, for me, I believe that, you know, all art and the humanities can really inspire and empower us. I believe it can also educate us about, you know, certain issues, in this case, you know, environmental justice and climate change. I feel like the arts are a very powerful form of science and climate communication, where we can learn about certain issues, but through a very personal, human and emotional framework. So for me, that's really the power of poetry and the environmental arts.
Yeah, that's, to consider that science communication, I think that's spot on. We're all of us here are science communicators. We do it all in very different ways. And I think that multifaceted approach is really inspires me. Let's see. So one thing that's really powerful in your poetry is the way you blend your own personal anecdotes with history and scientific truth. I'm wondering if you have any specific ideas about how you intend to approach that, or like when you use specific means to get your ideas across.
Yeah, definitely. For me, I try to weave together the, you know, the personal and the historical, political, and the cultural, and at the same time try to weave together the local and the global, and then of course the past, present, and the future. And you know, so much about, you know, what some call an eco-consciousness is to see how everything is interconnected, you know, from humans and animals to land and water, and so on. And so I try to write poetry or eco-poetry that embodies that eco-consciousness, where I can articulate how you know, everything is interconnected. It makes it very difficult to write sometimes, but also a good challenge as an artist to try to express all those connections.
Yeah. Can you speak a little bit more about that term eco-poetry? We haven't defined it here yet, but I know it's a term that your work, it describes your work. I believe Ruth's work also falls under eco-poetry.
Yeah, so there are many definitions. You know, when I teach eco-poetry courses, I usually just give a basic definition of poetry that is about nature, ecology, environmental justice, wilderness, human-animal relations, climate change, and so on. But some scholars think of it, you know, more in terms of like environmental justice, where, you know, it's a kind of poetry that goes beyond nature poems, which are usually just poems that kind of praise nature as a space of deep reflection, which of course it is. But unfortunately in our times, you know, nature has been so changed and damaged that, you know, when writing about nature, you're often, you know, have to also write about, you know, environmental justice and contamination and waste and so on. And so that's just a very basic definition of eco-poetry.
Oh, thank you so much. Let's see. Ruta wants to know if your daughter is an activist yet.
she's very strong-willed. My daughter is now 8, and we have taken her to many activist marches and events. And I performed at the climate change march here in Hawaii a few years ago, and she was in the audience. So still very young, but hopefully she'll join the youth climate justice movement, which is so powerful.
Yeah, it definitely seems like she's in the correct environment to learn. Okay, well, thank you so much, Craig, for sharing. I think Christina's coming back. There we go.
Thank you so much, Craig. Thank you so much, Craig and Ruth and Rachel, for such a wonderful special edition of Night School. On a personal note, this is my last Night School episode that I'm going to be co-hosting. I've been doing this for the last 2.5 years, and it's been such a joy to spend Thursday nights here with all of you. Thank you so much to the regulars who have made it possible to keep this program ongoing. And it's not the last episode of Night School, don't worry, just mine. So and then just also on another personal note, like the guests tonight have really hit me close to home because I have a 1.5-year-old daughter and I want her to love the natural world so much. And obviously, like, climate anxiety was a large discussion before we had her, but being at the Academy and hearing from all our guests on Night School, hearing about their work they're doing to help the natural world has made me feel more hopeful and has made my world so much bigger. I just notice so much more now. So I hope Night School has been able to do that for you, just make your world a little bigger. So that's my personal note. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Christina. You'll be deeply, deeply missed. We here at Night School are going to take a little winter break for the month of January. We're going to take some time off. But starting in February, we will be back the first Thursday of every month, bringing you all of natural science's coolest researchers, creators, innovators. Our next program will center around species that have been rediscovered after being presumed extinct. They're called Lazarus species. So please join us on February 2nd for the return of Night School in 2023. Appropriately titled Night School Back from the Dead.
And you know what we're gonna say, if you're watching this on YouTube, subscribe to our channel so you won't miss Night School when it comes back in February. Darian and Aria are taking over, so you're in excellent hands. And we'll see you in 2023. Have a wonderful New Year's, everybody. And thank you for joining us. I'm not going to do that.